Let's be real about it. Can I be real for a couple seconds? You're not looking at nothing. something that I say. You're not hearing what I say because your eyes are glued to how my wife is going to react towards me and how my children are going to react towards me because they are my first ministry. And if the Lord is blessing them, then you'll follow. But if the Lord is not blessing them because they're not listening to me, why should you listen? Wow! That was for free, by the way. That was for free. Hallelujah. Whatever that is that we've already said the prayer, I would ask you real fast to just go with me to 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. 1 Samuel, chapter 16. Whew. 1 Samuel, chapter 16. Bless you. And we'll start at verse 7. I don't know if it's customary for you all to stand. We ask that you stand in reverence of the reading of God's word. First Samuel, listen to me, chapter 16, verse 11, and it reads thus, 1 Samuel 16, verse 11, it says, and Samuel said unto Jesse, are all thy children, are here all thy children? He said, there remaineth yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was rooted and withal of a beautiful countenance, and God and goodly to look unto. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Verse 13 says, then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brother. And the Spirit of the Lord came unto David upon David from that day forward. So Samuel arose and went to Ramah. Verse 13, it says, then Samuel took the horn of oil, anointed him in the midst of his brother, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. You go ahead and take a seat right now. As you take a seat, look at your neighbor and just quote the subject for tonight, I've got power to somebody. Now, you know, the way that y'all said that just now, you wouldn't think that you had any kind of power. Y'all laugh, but when you say certain things, you got to speak it as if it is already done. It's already there. I have got power. I've got power. Look at somebody else. Don't look at that same name you looked at because they know you ain't got no power. So look at somebody else and scare them and say, I've got power. That sounds much better. Whew. This is going to be good, isn't it?
Come on.
I've got power. I've got power. If I could just for a couple seconds just go back and talk about some things here. First and foremost, at the beginning of this chapter, we find that Samuel is in mourning. Samuel is sad. Samuel is sad because the young man that he anointed at the beginning to be king has been rejected. He had been rejected because he was disobedient. I don't know what all that, but we will just say that he had been rejected. He was rejected. He was rejected. And the Bible says that God appeared to Samuel and said, Samuel, how long will you mourn over what I have rejected?
Come on,
my goodness. Can I put a comment on there and talk about it for a couple seconds? Don't you realize that for so long we have been mourning over things that God has been trying to cut off of us? And you crying about it.
Yes, sir.
He's trying to cut some stuff. You know, I was on my granddad used to teach me a little lesson about some things. And if you don't realize it, what really happens is when you're pruning a tree or when you're pruning a bush, you're not pruning the bush to hurt the tree. You want your tree to grow. You want your bush to grow. You want your blossoms to come out. You want your roses to bloom. You don't want to keep that stuff just sitting there and growing. God is trying to make you beautiful. Stop crying over spilled milk. It ain't doing you no good in no way. Clean it up and do
something.
Tell it. Okay, here we go. I'm trying to pull back, but you know, I feel somebody pushing me. I don't want to be pushed. Hallelujah. So this is what happens. What happens is there is a plan. Look at your neighbor and say, there is a plan. I tell you what kind of plan it is. There is a heavenly plan, a celestial setup, a design, a divine design, a spiritual strategy to bring promotion.
All right. Come on.
God, somebody, maybe I need to explain the story a little bit more. So what God does is God tells get Samuel, but I got another chicken in the oven that's cooking, that's getting ready to come out.
Oh, okay, that's fine.
Yeah. So what happens is now he says, I tell you what, Samuel, this is what I need you to do. Samuel gets all frightened because he's afraid that if he goes into the land, that the king that has been rejected is going to kill him. So the Lord says, don't worry about it. I got your hook up.
All right. Yeah, come on. Yeah.
Some people don't realize that God has got your hook up. He's just simply waiting on you to get on your job.
Come on,
man. God told me. Can I go a little bit further here? So there was a plan, and the plan was, this is what I want you to do. I want you to take a sacrifice. And when you take this sacrifice, I need you to call for Jesse and his family. Call Jesse. Jesse will come forward. Get Jesse. Come on, Jesse. Call Jesse. Jesse got some sons that I need, that one of his sons in particular is somebody that I have designed to do great things.
Okay.
Can I put that for a couple seconds? Listen, when you put your family name down there, and I got some people in your family that got a divine design, I'm getting ready to walk some things through that individual.
Okay, you just keep that there. That's all right. I'm gonna have a good time all by myself.
Listen, so what happens is now Samuel, now God gives Samuel the plan. He says, I give you a plan. Now, stick with the plan to a T. And then all of a sudden, Samuel gets into the land, and what happens is they see Samuel coming, and they get a little scary. Like, are you coming in peace, or are you getting ready to mess up some stuff? You telling us we got death that's about to come our way. What you got, priest? What you got to tell me now, priest? I want to hear what you got to say right now. You got to deal with death. All I want to know is, why are you here? Are you here for something other than telling somebody they about to die? The man of God says, this is what I have going on, young man. What I have going on is, I'm just here to make a sacrifice. I come in peace. But what I need you to do is, I need you to point me into the direction of Jesus.
Yeah, amen.
Come on. Yeah, come on. I need you to bring Jesse in my direction. I want Jesse to be a part of this. I got to sanctify Jesse and his people so that when it's time, you know, I can go ahead on and we can offer the sacrifice as Jesse. Okay. Now, so what happens is now that Jesse, he found Jesse. And what he's trying to do is he's trying to sort through to find one that for this secret plan, the secret mission. Everybody ever been on a secret mission?
Well, everybody done got holy on me now.
Don't y'all make me come down. I done already got down when I was up there smiling earlier. I was smiling because I found my road number to go to. I found my road. I think it's row 11, 12, and 13 back. Oh yeah, you know. So I got my road. I'm gonna believe y'all have been here. A couple of y'all haven't been here, but what I'd like to do is in a couple seconds, I'm gonna come down there. And if you're not giving me the amens and the hallelujahs and the thank you Lord, then I'm gonna come down here and we're gonna become personal. So that way we can all understand what's going on. Is that all right with y'all? That was about four, so I guess it's about time for us to go down. I'm gonna give a couple more seconds to warm up, give a couple more seconds to warm up. And just in case, okay? So what happens is now Jesse says, he has Jesse, and he brings Jesse's kids in, and you know, he's trying to find the right one. But you know, again, it's under that secret. Anybody ever been in a, okay, can I tell on myself for a second? I'm trying to be transparent. I've been on secret missions before.
Amen. Yes, sir.
I'm talking about any kind of secret mission. It ain't got to be a good secret mission either.
Amen. Come on.
Somebody got to tell me the truth now. I need to give me some truth. You know, again, y'all know what I told y'all the other day. I said, you know, these children think that they super slick, but sometimes you got to let them know, hey, I've been there. I've done that. You're not slick. And now, thank you for Jesus. That's right. As a matter of fact, you all jacked up. You don't understand it. You ain't as sneaky as you think you are. Hallelujah. So the secret mission goes on. Now we talk about a spiritual secret mission. Now we talk about a secular secret mission. Spiritual secret mission. Spiritual. Listen. So what happens is now he says he's getting ready to make a choice. You know, the Lord is telling him that there is one of his sons that I want you to anoint. There is one of his sons that I want you to authorize. There is one of his sons that I want you to give power. There is one of his sons that I want you to pour oil on, because he will be the future king of Israel. He will be the one that does great things. He will be the one that's going to set the captives free.
He says, okay, so the eldest always needs to come first. The eldest always comes first. And now, mind you, Samuel is still fresh off the wound from Saul. He's still fresh off of that rejection from Saul. But you know, when Eliab walks in, he says, surely it's him. Surely he's got to be the one. Surely he's got the look. He's got that key. He walks with his head up. He walks with his back straight. You know how we stretch and you know we got it together? Oh yes. He points his toes in the right direction. He drags his feet just a little. You know how royalty do it sometimes. You know, they have a difference. If you look at royalty walks way more differently than a normal individual. Yes. Why? Because they're taught at a young age how to walk straight.
Hallelujah.
They're taught at a young age how to pronounce their words. They're taught at a young age how to be able to sit and eat with some manners and some dignity. They're taught at a young age how to do certain things. But wait a minute. But aren't we supposed to be the same ones that do the same thing? Because if I'm right, my Bible tells me that we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. We're supposed to be the ones that set the standard. I hope y'all getting this. This is good. Man, I'm enjoying myself. So what happens is the first son walks in and the Lord tells him no, but he said, Lord, wait a minute, surely he's got to be the one. But why not him? And the Lord stops him and gives him a divine warning, a heavenly caution, a celestial suggestion. Isn't it amazing that many are still operating in an area that they have been fired from, but because nobody is in position.
Come on.
That's our fault. People have been fired and don't even realize it. Oh, okay. Maybe I need to slow down a little bit. My coffee was here telling me that I need to slow down a little bit. I should have done that simply really did that. That's my bad. Yeah, I'm mad. I can say that. Jesus, really? I'm away. Yes, that's my wife. I can say what I want. That's my wife. That's not what I'm talking about. Sitting with kids. My Lord, y'all. Come on. Come on back. Lord have mercy. So what he says is, isn't it amazing that we're still operating in an area that they've been fired from, but because nobody is in position, nobody is waiting to take over the reins. Remember, yesterday we talked about this. Yesterday we said the reason why nobody is waiting, or nobody is in the reins, or nobody is available, nobody is in position, because nobody's willing to train somebody. Nobody wants to take time out to say, look, I got you. Look, son, let me pull you to the side. Let me show you what's right. Excuse me, man. Let me get you for a second and show you what you need to do. It used to be a time where the older women would take the younger women and show them how to cook and clean.
Yes. That's right.
Ooh, Jesus, I'm going to hit you. Can I go over? Can I be for real for a second? Nowadays, grandma is 40, 50, 60 years old. I'm telling you now, if my grandma got up and started twerking, we'd have an issue.
Yes, sir.
Y'all laughing. Let me be real. If my grandma got up here talking about she's doing the same thing, grandma, mama, you need to sit down somewhere. But in the Bible, Titus tells me that the women ought to be sober and the aged women ought to be telling the teaching these younger women how they're supposed to carry themselves. Come on, Angela Bassett is a beautiful woman. She's beautiful because she's a class act.
Wow.
Yeah.
Let's be real about it for a second. Angela Bassett is gorgeous, beautiful woman. But you know what? You can't see all of her body parts. When she walks around with elegance and beauty and grace. And that's what the older women are supposed to be teaching these younger women. Young men, stop wearing your pants off your business. Come on. Don't let the you do. If you understood the story behind it, you wouldn't do it. If you understood what comes with that, is it, you know, it was a. I don't know if any of y'all ever heard of a young man by the name of Felice Jones.
Come
the folks that are out there that are hiring, they're looking at you and watching you to see what you got on. If you come in here with your pants all the way down. Don't nobody want to see your drawers that you done had on for 3 days. Ain't washed your butt yet. That's nasty. What female you think gonna respect you? Know, we trying to get the black man that's trying to get some respect and trying to build ourselves up. How can we build ourselves up when all we see is not drawers? That don't mean nothing. But ain't nothing like a black man that can stand up and walk and speak like somebody gave him some education. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. That's the reason why nobody is in position right now. Nobody's in position because our older men don't want to take the time with these young men. Come here, young fella. Pull your pants up, first of all. Where your belt at? You know, it used to be a time where older men would say something. Now it's like they done wear their hands up and done gave up on the black men. I wasn't even supposed to be going there, but thank you, Lord, that's still good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, the people, it's really funny that we are the only ones that think it's cool to say it.
Oh, really?
We are the only ones that think it's cool to show you what. We the only ones that...
I'm going to get some nerve from this because I can't stand
it. I can't stand to see, and this is just me. This is Stats. This is Lewis. This ain't the church. Sir, this is Lewis. This is Lewis. I can say that because they don't, you know, a lot of folks think that part that the church believes in this. This is not what he stands for, the church. Yeah, I stand for the church. This is Lewis. I cannot stand to see the super duper type virgin where they, you can see everything. I'm talking about it. I'm not going to get on my nerves, but take the pants off and something else.
That's right. Amen.
I love him to death. But you know, you represent stuff when you walk outside those doors.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, that was a little bit. So let me get back to the list. So what we got going on here is now that now he has eight brothers total to the group date. But what happens is all seven of them come in.
Uh-huh.
All of them come in. And all of them are rejected. All of them say no. The Lord says no. That's not it. No, that's not it. No, that's not it. How many times has the Lord told us no, and we jumped at the no? We said no, Lord. You don't know what you're talking about. Could you imagine what would have happened had Samuel anointed the wrong king?
Yes, sir.
Could you imagine just for a couple seconds how much turmoil Israel would be in had he anointed king? Okay, I'm gonna move forward. So let's get to the good part, Stacks. You know, you're boring me right now with all this stuff. So, boy, you know, this is what happens. What happens is now the seventh son walks in and he says no, and he says, is this all you got? Have you really given your God your heart? I say that again because I felt that. Have you given God your heart? Have you given God your all? Or are you reserved in something? You know, a lot of times what we like to do is we don't like to give God our all because the person we see the next to, it gets on our nerves. There's an issue when you allow people to dictate your response to an all-powerful God. There is an issue when you let somebody have more power over you than God has over you. So he says the same. He says to Jesse.
I can see that.
Jesse, is this all you got? He said, no, I got one more. But he don't want him.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
That was another good one. You don't want him.
Come on.
You don't want him. He ain't no. You don't want him. He's the youngest one I got. He ain't. You know, it's crazy that a lot of times we don't even allow people. The people that are not qualified is who God has already chosen.
Yes.
You didn't realize that. Your qualifications don't make you. It's God's calling that makes you qualified.
Yes.
Man, that's Jesus. I'm going to go ahead. So he says, know, he's out there with the sheep. I don't know if anybody ever had to do any shepherd work or any, you know, dealing with flocks or anything like that. But you know, what I've been told that people that take care of sheep, a lot of times the reason why the sheep follow certain people is because they have a scent. Yeah. And a lot of times the sheep follow their own scent. So David had a scent about him that caused the sheep to follow him. I hope y'all understand this. He had a scent about him that was causing the sheep to follow him. And for us, it may stink, but to the sheep, that's my leader right there. I'm gonna go ahead, I promise, I promise. He talks about he's keeping the sheep. He said, well, before we sit down, we got to get him in here, because I got to see that this is who God has called. So he brings the young man in, and the young man walks in, you know, I'm almost certain he walked in with his head down, because I'm sure that he didn't take a shower or didn't take a bath, and you know, he smelled like sheep, and he felt like he wasn't qualified. He didn't know what he was coming in on. But guess what? There is something good that God has for you when you allow him the opportunity to take care of him. Okay, there we go. This is what happens. He comes in and immediately the Bible says that Samuel had to get up because God said, you need to anoint him, for this is he. You know, we ought to be looking at our kids right now, but looking at our kids and saying, hey children, we need to anoint you. We need to anoint you. If you don't, I tell you what, this is the problem. The problem is when they took prayer out of schools, yeah, they were looking for the parents to take care of their children. Oh, man! They took prayer out of schools, and look, now they're looking for the parents to be the ones to take care of their kids. And we need you to be praying over your kids, because we can't miss church and stay. I'm sorry, but we have to be the ones to pray over. You ought to be thanking God that you got some teachers in there that are praying over the school. You ought to thank God you got some principals that are praying over the school. You ought to be thankful that you got some janitors that are in there sweeping. They're saying, thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. You ought to be thankful that the folks that are walking around jingling their keys, they might be saying, thank you, Lord, for touching these children.
Yes, sir.
Oh, my God. This is what's going on. So he says, anoint. And then, now, there was a point that I really wanted to make here. Verse 13, it says that then Samuel took the horn of oil. He took a horn of oil. He took a horn of oil. When Samuel anointed Saul, he said to have a vial of oil. They don't get you excited about this. Listen, he took the horn of oil for David. For Saul, he only had a vial of oil, which shows me that the horn is bigger, it's secure, and it's a whole lot more of it. But with the oil, the vial is something that could be broken, something that's brittle, something he can get a little bit of the anointing. But with David, he came in and he poured all the oil. It's gonna get better to you, I promise you, in a couple of seconds. And the Bible says that he took the horn of oil and he anointed him in the midst of his brethren. All those people that were qualified, he anointed David. All those people that had all of the notches under their belt, he still anointed David. For everybody else that said you couldn't make it, he anointed you in front of David. Oh my God, I hope y'all get this. I'm trying to take my time, baby. The best part about all of this anointing was that the Spirit of the Lord came upon David. Can I go ahead and talk about those things? Yeah. I got power. The Spirit of the Lord came upon David. I had to tell you the story to take you to the next story, the Spirit. But the Lord comes in and the Lord gives you power. The Lord gives you authority. The Lord gives you the ability to speak things into existence. The Lord gives you the ability to say that I can make it. The Lord gives you the ability to say I can go further. I am more than a conqueror.
Goodness.
Yeah. Now this is the first. There was one. I got two examples. And the one example comes, you know, there was a transfer of power. Saul had the anointing, but the anointing was taken from him, and the anointing was given to David. It was taken from Saul, given to David. Now here's the crazy thing. The crazy thing is that although the anointing was taken, Saul was still the king. Although the anointing was taken, Saul was still the king. Now here's the crazy part. The crazy part is David still had to grow into this anointing. David had to grow into this power. David had to grow into what God is doing through him. David had to grow into this burning that was on the inside of him. Okay, all right, that's fine. You're sitting there looking at me crazy. Yeah, maybe God need to come down. Now, you ready for us to go down now? I'm about ready to go down. I'm about for us to go down here. Because everybody looking at me strange. They looking at me strange, don't realize that there is an anointing in this place. There's an anointing. There's some power on the inside of you. And all we're trying to do is unlock your potential. You don't even realize how much potential you got on the inside of you. So, all right, first example, Saul going crazy. So what happens is they say, we got to get him some music therapy. He gets some music therapy. He says, I know a man. I know a young man that plays skill. And he was talking about David. He brings David in. And you know, I think that this is my personal opinion. I think that when David started playing, then he started to sense, Saul started to sense something that he ain't felt in a long time. I think he's thick. You know how sometimes you get, I like cool water and curb and stuff. You know, a lot of times when you wear the same scent, you smell it on somebody, like, hey man, that's a good scent you got on. Well, I think that as he started playing, Saul recognized the scent that he hadn't smelled in a long time.
Yes.
And that's the scent that calmed him. That's the scent that caused these evil spirits to wear off. He felt the anointing. He sent something that he had felt before. Wait a minute. That feels eerily familiar. I don't know what it is, but it's something about the way this young man is playing. I got to keep having him here. I need him here. What Saul didn't realize was that the anointing had been taken from him and the anointing had been given to him. Okay, so that was